Welcome to Zion as we celebrate the fifth Sunday of Pentecost. Our church is blessed by your presence in our worship today, and we pray that this time you share with us brings you comfort, peace, hope, and a greater understanding towards strengthening your faith in our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. Zion is blessed with a strong community of Christians who are faithful in sharing their time, talents, gifts, and prayers with those who are in need. As a family of faith, we have helped people in our community and throughout the world. We especially thank the volunteers of Street Soldiers, the Three Churches Caregiving Ministry, and all the missions that Zion, Emmanuel, and Trinity Lutheran Churches of Schenectady and Niskayuna support within our churches, community, and throughout the world. We are God's people, together as one, doing his work. Thank you, and God bless you.
Grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all. In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. In the Word was life, and the life was the light of all people. The Word became flesh and lived among us, and we have seen his glory, full of grace and truth. We begin with our confession. If we say we have no sin, we deceive ourselves, and the truth is not in us. But if we confess our sins, God, who is faithful and just, will forgive our sins and cleanse us from all unrighteousness. Take a brief moment of silence and reflection. Let us then confess our sins to God our Father. Most merciful God, we confess that we are by nature sinful and unclean. We have sinned against you in thought, word, and deed, by what we have done and by what we have left undone. We have not loved you with our whole heart. We have not loved our neighbors as ourselves. We justly deserve your present and eternal punishment. For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, have mercy on us. Forgive us, renew us, and lead us, so that we may delight in your will and walk in your ways to the glory of your holy name. Amen. The absolution. Almighty God, in his mercy, has given his Son to die for you, and for his sake forgives you all your sins. As he called and ordained the servant of Christ, and by his authority, I therefore forgive you all your sins in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen.
Psalm 145, verses 1 through 14. I will extol you, my God and King, and bless your name forever and ever. Every day I will bless you and praise your name forever and ever. Great is the Lord and greatly to be praised, and his greatness is unsearchable. One generation shall commend your works to another and shall declare your mighty acts. On the glorious splendor of your majesty and on your wondrous works, I will meditate. They shall speak of the mighty, of your awesome deeds, and I will declare your greatness. They shall pour forth the fame of your abundant goodness and shall sing aloud of your righteousness. The Lord is gracious and merciful, slow to anger and abounding in steadfast love. The Lord is good to all, and his mercy is over all that he has made. All your works shall give thanks to you, O Lord, and all your saints shall bless you. They shall speak of the glory of your kingdom and tell of your power, to make known to the children of man your mighty deeds and the glorious splendor of your kingdom. Your kingdom is an everlasting kingdom, and your dominion endures throughout all generations. The Lord is faithful in all his words and kind in all his works. The Lord upholds all who are falling and raises up all who are bowed down.
Have you not known? Have you not heard? The Lord is the everlasting God, the creator of the ends of the earth. He does not faint or grow weary. His understanding is unsearchable. He gives power to the faint, and to him who has no might, he increases his strength. Even youths shall fall faint and be weary, and young men shall fall exhausted. But they who wait for the Lord shall renew their strength. They shall mount up with wings like eagles. They shall run and not be weary. They shall walk and not faint. This is the word of the Lord.
Thank you.
The epistle is from Ephesians chapter 4. Unity in the body of Christ. I, therefore, a prisoner for the Lord, urge you to walk in a manner worthy of the calling to which you have been called, with all humanity and gentleness, with patience, bearing with one another in love, eager to maintain the unity of the Spirit in the bond of peace. This is one body and one Spirit, just as you were called to the one that belongs to your call, one Lord, one faith, one baptism, one God, and Father of all, who is over all, and through all, and in all. This is the word of the Lord. Praise be to God.
Holy Gospel, according to St. Luke, the 18th chapter. This is the parable of the persistent widow. And he told them a parable to the effect that they ought always to pray and not lose heart. He said, in a certain city there was a judge who feared God nor respected feared God nor respected man. And there was a widow in that city who kept coming to him and saying, give me justice against my adversary. For a while he refused, but afterward he said to himself, though I neither fear God nor respect man, yet because this widow keeps bothering me, I will give her justice so that she will not beat me down by her continual coming. And the Lord said, hear what the unrighteous judge says, and will not God give justice to his elect who cry to him day and night? Will he delay long over them? I tell you, he will give justice to them speedily. Nevertheless, when the Son of Man comes, will he find faith on earth? Question? This is the gospel of the Lord. So, children, today is the fifth Sunday after Pentecost, and we're happy to be here again, and pretty sure you're looking forward for this children's story or message. For those of you who've been listening for the past couple of weeks, we're talking about this tree and the fruit of that is bearing on this tree. We talk about love, we talked about joy, we talked about peace, and today another fruit. It's called patience. Let me see all those who like to wait. Put your hands up. You have to wait for something. Okay. I am not seeing you, but Jesus is seeing you. So if you're lying, you need to repent. So Sally, this little girl, she went with her mom to visit grandma. And when she went to grandma, grandma has a wonderful, beautiful plot of land that she has a flower garden, a nice piece of land, and she dedicated that for her flower garden. And it was so beautiful, all the beautiful roses, red and white, and it was very colorful, tulips, and very nice. And Sally was so taken back with this flower garden. On her way back home, she told her mom, Mom, you know what? I want to do exactly what grandma did. I love what she did. And so mom says, fine, why not? We will do it. We have a piece of land. We can do it. So mom and Sally went to Home Depot and they got their things that they need, the topsoil and, you know, things to get rid of the grass and to prepare the soil and the seeds and everything. And she picked out some nice roses that she wants for the garden. And Sally was excited, so excited that they worked for the first 2 days. They were working, enjoying it. And she was thinking about this flower garden that grandma has. And she's visualizing how her flower garden will be so beautiful, like grandma's. And so they finished preparing the soil, they put the seeds in, they watered it. First day, she watered it. Second day, watered it. Third day, a week passed, and Sally is seeing nothing. Nothing is coming up. And Sally is getting impatient. She's saying, what's happening here? I want to see flowers. I want to see something going up. And the second week, same thing. And Sally got frustrated. She started to blame mommy. Probably we didn't plant it right. Mommy, probably we're watering it too much. Mommy, we didn't do the right thing. Mommy. And guess what? Sally, after the third week, Sally forgot about this beautiful garden that she was imagining. But the mother, she continued. Sally went to play with her friends, and she's doing all kinds of things, but she forgot about the garden. Sally's mom continued to water the plants, water the garden and everything. And then, guess what? In a couple of weeks, in 4 or 5 weeks, it started to bloom. It started to come up, the flowers and the roses. And then Sally went back one day and she saw it. And she said, Mom, why was I so, why didn't I wait? What's happening? Why didn't I wait and for this thing to germinate? And guess what? She felt bad for herself and, you know, she asked Mom for forgiveness. Guess what? Not only Sally, all of us, we have those times in our lives when we want things to happen almost immediately. Remember, you don't have patience. Your brother is playing with the toys and you want the toy and you don't want to wait. Remember your birthday present? You don't want to wait to hear what you're getting. You're so impatient. And that's one of the things that we want to talk about today briefly, to have patience. Jesus is expecting us, as young as you are, to have patience, to wait a little. Sometimes we don't get things, like I will say in my message, everything is instant today, but there are times when we have to wait. How do we get patience? Well, only the Holy Spirit can give us that patience. And so even wherever you go, at school, at home, on the playground, you practice patience. And like I said, you cannot do it by yourselves. You need the Holy Spirit to help you. And all of us, children and adults, to have this patience. So I'm going to pray with you today, and we're going to ask God to help you, that you wouldn't be like Sally, to just give up, but you will continue to have the patience waiting. You see, God's timing is always the right timing. So, Father, I lift these kids before you today. And I ask you, God, of your mercies, young as they are, God, you're living in a generation where everything becomes instant. God, I pray that you help not only them, but all of us to have patience, because this is what you're expecting of us as your children. So we give you all the praise, the glory, and the honor. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Thank you, children. Grace, mercy, and peace be unto you from our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. So for the past couple of weeks, we've been dealing with the fruit of the Spirit. And we started with love, for those of you who have been following, joy, and last week we did peace. I'm pretty sure you would know what's the next fruit that we will be talking about. It's patience. Patience. So every Monday morning, myself and Pastor Chip, Pastor Matthew Schultz, Elder Paul, and Deacon Paul Albrechtset from Trinity Lutheran Church, we would spend about an hour and a half or 2 hours doing our sermon prep, and we talk about what we will be doing and how we will present the sermon for you who are listening with the help of the Holy Spirit, that He will speak to your hearts. And believe you me, this Monday I knew I was going into the office knowing that the internet in the office was off. And I said, I'm going there a little early to get things sorted out before. The meeting is at 11 o'clock. So I said, I give myself about an hour and a half to make sure the internet works because we are doing it via Zoom. And so I went in early, I called Verizon. And I, of course, you got the machine answering and they took all the information. Bearing in mind, we are doing patience for that day, right? That's this sermon today. And I did all my readings on patience. And then they keep telling you the first time they said somebody will be on the line shortly. And you will hear all of the representatives are busy. Please stay on the line. Your call is important to us. Thank you for your patience. And I said, how funny on this day that I'm doing patience that this is happening to me at 9:30, 10 o'clock, and all after every 10 minutes or 5 minutes, you hear the same thing over and over again. All our representatives are busy. Please stay on the line. Your call is important to us. Thank you for your patience. 10:15, the same thing. 10:20, the same thing. 10:30, the same thing. 15 minutes to 11, the same thing. And I said, God, what are you teaching me here today? Patience, right? It so happened that I had to cut them off because I couldn't wait anymore. I had to go to the meeting. Isn't God wonderful? When you preach a message, he teaches you before you preach the message. Well, I had to really have some patience. Thank God that's taken care of, and yeah, all is well. Please wait. That's the two most annoying words that you will ever hear. Please wait. What about you this morning? Your dishwasher just broke. Your internet, like me, just went out. You've been trying to get someone something fixed or something done. So you call customer service hoping that they will be able to walk you through or fix or send someone out there to get things back to normal as soon as possible. You've got things to do. You don't have time for this inconvenience or inconvenient delay. And that's when those two words rear its ugly head. Please wait. And then the next representative will be with you shortly. What about those of you waiting to get back to your jobs? The coronavirus hit and you're out of a job or you're temporarily out of a job. And you're getting impatient. No one likes to wait. Whether you're talking about waiting for customer service, a job promotion, a vacation, or for when we will be able to go outside without masks on our faces. We don't like to wait for anything. Being patient seems to be a thing of the past. We live in a world where everything seems instant. Instant messaging, instant coffee, instant oatmeal, instant information, instant everywhere. In fact, now we get so annoyed when our internet runs too slow. And we're not talking about minutes here. We're talking just about a couple seconds, and we get worked up. Everything is instant, or at least we expect it to be. This is a a right now generation we're living in. Yet today in our reading, Paul said from Ephesians, he says, I urge you to walk in a manner worthy of the calling to which you have been called, with all humility and gentleness, with patience. I checked the dictionary, the Webster dictionary, and patience is defined as the capacity to accept or tolerate a delay, trouble, or suffering without getting upset. Let me run that by you again. Patience, according to the Webster dictionary, is defined as the capacity to accept or tolerate a delay, trouble, or suffering without getting upset. I don't know when Webster wrote this definition, but this person, Merriam-Webster, clearly didn't have our culture in mind. Because when they said to accept a delay now in this generation, absolutely not. If the traffic is heavy, we get impatient. If I stand in the line at the grocery store, I get impatient. What about accepting trouble? With patience? We've already talked about losing our internet, which makes us lose our minds. But what about trouble with our neighbors? Are you patient with them when they are too loud? Or they don't clean up their yard? Or don't keep their dog or dogs or their pets quiet? No. Are you patient? Be honest. You're not. And what about suffering, according to the dictionary? Do we really have to ask? Do we really go through any suffering without knowing how to get rid of it? There's a pill or medication for everything. Do you want to lose weight instantly? There's medication for that. Pills promise that. So our culture does not do patience anymore. Remember the commercial, I want my money and I want it now. We want our way and we want it now. And that's the world we're living in. Let's be honest. But today, I thank God. I thank God for Jesus. It's a good thing that the God we believe in doesn't have our attention span. Just imagine if Jesus would have operated like us. I don't think it would go too well for us in our world. But luckily, we don't have to imagine an impatient God, because God is infinitely patient. Hear what Isaiah said today. The Lord is the everlasting God, the creator of the ends of the earth. He does not faint or grow weary. His understanding is unsearchable. So let's look at Jesus, how he did it. Jesus could only respond as he did to life's trial because he was filled with the Holy Spirit. We can ask ourselves the question, how could any man be as patient as he was? How could he keep his cool under constant fire? How could he demonstrate so much grace, so much compassion, and at the same time, with so much determination? And when faced with the Pharisees, who continued to badger and bait him, how could he restrain himself from punching their lights out? You see, Jesus, he was a man walking upon this earth. He had emotions. He was 100% man and 100% God. So he had emotions like we do today. So what was it that gave him the edge that we so often lack? And we heard it. He does not grow weary. He does not grow weary. He doesn't grow weary of forgiving us. He doesn't grow weary as we tell him to please wait, as we struggle with our sin in our lives. He doesn't give up on us. Instead, God is infinitely patient. Out of his love for us, he gives us chance after chance after chance. He lets us start over again and again and again. He never seems to run out of patience, as even as we mess up from time and time again. We walk away from him. We don't do the things he's asked us to do. But does he grow impatient with us? In fact, instead of getting angry at us, instead of losing patience with our failings, God took upon himself and he went to Calvary's cross. He decided to take all of our sins, the sin of the whole wide world, and patiently bear it on the cross so that all we know, all we would know, is his infinite mercy, his infinite grace, his infinite patience. But isn't that what patience is after all? Grace put into practice, grace in action, overlooking the small annoyances, the big blunders, the times when things don't go the way they're supposed to. Isn't that exactly what God does for you and for me every single day? He receives you, messed up you, you without getting angry or upset. Patience is grace, forgiveness, reconciliation put into practice. And if we are honest, brothers and sisters of Zion Lutheran Church, or wherever you're listening to this sermon, if we are honest with ourselves, God gets a lot of practice of patience with each and every one of us. And it is God's patience with us through Jesus Christ that leads us to live radically different lives when it comes to practicing patience through the working of the Holy Spirit. While the world around us grows more impatient, more judgmental, as we, as God's people, walking in step with the Spirit of God, the Holy Spirit helps us to be more patient. We look back to the cross, at how God deals with our mistakes and our missteps, our slowness to change, our lack of doing things the way he wants us to do. And then, with the renewed strength of the Spirit of God in us, we practice that same patience in every situation with the help of the Holy Spirit. And when we are annoyed, when we are delayed, when we face trouble, even when we face suffering, the Holy Spirit is there to help us to practice the patience we learn from Jesus Christ on the cross. And so, brothers and sisters, when our children don't do what we ask the first time, we practice patience. When we are stuck in traffic, we practice patience. When we are in a hurry, what someone else isn't, we practice patience. When we see suffering in our world, we patiently work to make it right. When someone causes trouble in our office, in our homes, our school, our church, we practice patience that the Holy Spirit is going to be teaching us day after day. Because remember, like love, and joy, and peace, patience is one of the fruits of the Spirit. And the more we practice, the better we get at it. The more we use it, the more we will have. Why? Because we are walking in step with the Holy Spirit daily, asking the Holy Spirit to help us in this area of our lives. So for us as Christians, I love the Webster Dictionary definition, but myself and Elder Paul came up with this one. It says, patience is actively doing what God wants us to do, regardless of what we want the outcome to be. See that again? Patience is actively doing what God wants us to do, regardless of what we want the outcome to be. See, the power of patience isn't just what it does in us and for us. The real benefit of our practicing patience is what happens around us. When we practice, when we are patient at home, there is more peace in our homes, more understanding, more laughter. Patience changes our homes. And when we practice it with our co-workers, our workplace becomes healthier, a better place to be. When we practice patience in our cars, the roads are safer. When we practice patience with those we disagree with or those who annoy us, we don't have to apologize later for things we should not have said. In a world so intent on instant, what is more noticeable, more powerful than someone right in the midst of the craziness, the stress, the hustle, and the bustle, that someone taking a moment to practice patience? Is it easy? By no means. Is it fun? Not at all times. Is it powerful? Yes, it is. Patience is a very real power of God's grace and forgiveness. Coming through you directly into the lives of others, what could be more powerful than that? So the next time you find yourself in a situation where you're being ask to practice patience, or the Holy Spirit is convicting you to practice patience, remember exactly what is happening. God is working through you in that very moment. Remember that you are being given the opportunity to showcase or show someone that God has what God has already showed you. Remember, we are walking in step with the Spirit. In closing, when I came to Trinity Lutheran Church in 2011, and I heard about Zion Lutheran Church, I heard about Emmanuel Lutheran Church, my prayer was that we come together and we work together. And I prayed that prayer. I talked to some of the pastors, great men of God, but things did not happen then. But I continued to pray. Did I get frustrated? Yes, I was frustrated at times. Why can't we as three churches work together? I've never been to Zion Lutheran Church preaching like this since 2011. But I prayed. I did not give up. And look what's happening today. You see, God's timing is the right timing. God has brought the three churches together, and we are working together. street soldiers, the three church fun of which I have the awesome responsibility to overlook. And I, like I said before, I hear the stories. I see what God is doing through what you has been, you at Zion and Emmanuel and Trinity has been contributing. God's timing is always the right timing. So I've learned to practice patience and thank God that my patience worked out. We're working together. So the peace of God that passeth all understanding, keep our hearts and minds in Christ Jesus. Amen.
Join me in the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended into hell. The third day he rose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven and sits at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Christian Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen.
Let us pray for the people of God and for all people according to their needs. For the church and her witness of hope to the world, that in every city, village, and home across the globe, the voice of the Lord may be heard by the faithful preachings of the gospel. Let us pray to the Lord. Merciful Father, we give you thanks for all your goodness and grace, especially for the gift of your Son, Jesus Christ. Instill your word in us, that we may share the message of Jesus Christ to bring comfort and peace to others inspired by you, O Lord. God, strengthen our faith. Bless your church and provide us what we need to be strong so that we can serve others. Grant your blessings to our pastors and their families, Patrick, Chip, Matthew, Mark, and to our Bishop Derek. Your called ministers who provide your inspired word to us faithfully so that we can be strengthened to grow in our faith and live a Christian life as you intended. Grant us to be worthy servants, to attend to your people who you place in our care. Lord, hear our prayer. Jesus, provide comfort to those who are persecuted unjustly. Be near to us and provide us reassurance of your unending love when we experience suffering and loss in sickness and in death. Keep us steadfast in your word through the teachings of the apostles, and let us hold fast that suffering in this world is temporary. Let us to reach out to those who have fallen away from your word and help them to restore their faith in you. Lord, hear our prayer. Lord, counsel the nations of the world and their leaders in paths of peace and justice to protect and care for their people, to provide help to those who are in need, to restore their dignity. Inspire these leaders to look to you for guidance. Enable them to work respectfully with one another, to make just decisions that will serve the people they govern. And make us good citizens who appreciate our gift of freedom for your purpose. Lord, hear our prayer. Holy Spirit, teach us to love one another as you have loved us. Bless and protect our medical providers, doctors, nurses, caregivers, police officers, EMTs, firefighters, and essential employees who work tirelessly and unselfishly to heal and protect us. Let people find peaceful means to promote positive change in our society with equal rights for all people. Lord, bless our military. Keep them healthy and strong to protect our nation's people, and bless all people throughout the world so that everyone can live in peace and freedom safely. We especially pray for Zion's sons and daughters who serve our country. Andrew, Ian, Patrick, and Paul, keep them safe, faithful, and strong. Let them know, though they may be distant, they are close within our hearts and minds. Lord, hear our prayer. Holy Spirit, bless those who are celebrating important events within their lives, especially those graduating from high school and college. Bless their future to be successful and fulfilling as they transition to higher education and meaningful employment. Continue to bless Jim and Sharon Seaman as they celebrate 40 years of marriage. We are grateful for their example of love for each other and pray that they will experience many more happy and healthy years together, enjoying time with family and friends. We are also grateful for the successful heart surgery for Larry Olson, and we will continue to pray for his recovery. God, hear our prayers. Bless us to carry out your work with those we are entrusted to by you to serve. And let us show our gratitude to those who serve us. In this we pray, through Jesus Christ, our Lord and Savior, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen.
Of the Lord be with you always. Merciful Father, we offer with joy and thanksgiving what you have first given us, ourselves, our time, and our possessions, signs of your gracious love. Receive them for the sake of him who offered himself for us, Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. In the words that Jesus gave us, we pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. Now may the Lord bless you and keep you. May the Lord make his face shine on you and be gracious to you. May the Lord look upon you with favor and give you his peace. Go in peace and serve the Lord. Mm-hmm.